Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to the first regional conference, Rethinking Sex, Building Healthy Relationships in a Hookup World. My name is Ashley Crouch. I'm the Assistant Program Director at Love and Fidelity. The Love and Fidelity Network began in 2007 in Princeton in response to a great need on campus, the need to engage in authentic and thoughtful dialogue in defense of sexual integrity, marriage, and the family. Just last month, I was at a national conference in Florida with 5,000 college students, talking to them about the work that we do, and the general consensus was, students are hungry for a conversation about these topics. So often, these topics are not addressed by faculty or students on campuses. The Love and Fidelity Network aims to equip college students with the information and tools that they need to instantiate healthy and meaningful relationships in their personal lives. We recognize a great need for young adults to be educated in this area in order to counteract the current cultural cycle of dating and dumping or hookups and heartbreaks. Last year, I was down in Virginia for the fabulous National Coalition of African American Marriages and Parenting Summit, a great two-day event that brought together key leaders to discuss marriages in the African American community. I was impressed by the constructive conversation throughout the event, but what stuck out to me most was what one young woman said at the very end of the summit. She said, "This is all great, but young adults have no idea how to make this happen in their personal lives. We need education to make this a reality." This is why we are here today. We have brought together three outstanding psychologists who are eager to share with you what their data and experience has taught them about what makes for healthy relationships. They are so eager, in fact, that they all braved a huge snowstorm to be here today and talk to you. We are grateful to have them here and are very much looking forward to their presentations. Our first speaker will be Dr. John Van Epp to discuss his findings on romantic attachment. Our second speaker will be Dr. Arndt Nielsen from Northwestern University to discuss intimacy and conflict resolution. Finally, this afternoon, we will have Dr. Linda Malone-Kalan from Hampton University, who was instrumental in founding the National Center for African American Marriages and Parenting that I referred to earlier. She will be presenting on friendships as a foundation for fidelity within marriage. Unfortunately, due to the weather, our moderator, Dr. Fitzgibbons, was not able to join us. So in his stead, we will be fielding questions and introducing the speakers. Matters of sex and relationships are often very sensitive issues, and for that reason, may be difficult to discuss. Many of the sentiments presented here today are rarely articulated on college campuses. All of you here come from a variety of different backgrounds, faith traditions, and worldviews, as do our speakers. While we may depart from each other in agreeing on certain topics, we are not concerned. In this diversity, there is a great opportunity to engage in robust and authentic dialogue about how to build healthy relationships. It is our hope that this conference will be for you a venue to thoughtfully approach these issues so that we can begin a respectful and fruitful conversation that will continue to impact your personal lives in the coming months and years. Regardless of your background or belief, we hope something you hear in these presentations will be applicable to you today. At the end of the day, we will all walk out those doors, and we will all be changed. We hope that we will walk away with an enriched and fuller understanding of what it takes to build healthy relationships. Socrates once said, "An unexamined life is not worth living." This is why we are here, to examine our lives and find concrete ways to make them more meaningful and fulfilling. So, as we begin, I invite you to reflect on your experiences and consider how these psychologists' remarks apply to you. Thank you all for coming. I will be available throughout the day to take questions about the Love and Fidelity Network. The executive director and founder of the Love and Fidelity Network, Cassandra Huff, will be available also to answer any questions. We are very happy to have this conference co-sponsored by the Anscombe Society in Princeton, the Anscombe Society at Providence College, and Radzinka at Columbia. Students from these groups will be helping to staff the conference. Please feel free to approach them with questions throughout the day about the work that they are doing. And now I will invite Rachel Wagley, the co-president of True Love Revolution, to say a few words.
If you guys, yeah, if you just want to like come down front and up here and just fill in spaces, there's more room. Wow, it's so exciting that we're filling up the room. I know that it's exciting for us to see you all here, and I'm really excited for the conference today. I'm Rachel Wagley. I'm a junior at Harvard. I'm the current co-president of True Love Revolution, along with Leo Kelleher right in the front. And we want to thank you for coming out this morning. I know it's early. Trust me, I know it's early. So it's exciting to have you here. We came together with the Love and Fidelity Network today to host a constructive conference. For those of you who know about True Love Revolution, you know that usually we're into deconstructing culture, deconstructing the hookup culture, deconstructing second wave feminism, challenging norms about marriage, the list goes on. But we're excited today for our speakers because we want to start constructing, we want to start building, we want to build a generation of college kids and high school kids and anyone else who's out there who take marriage seriously in this world where 50% of couples divorce. College is supposed to help you succeed in life. That's the mission of the university. Colleges build you up. They send you out into the community with life skills that will enrich our world. That's sort of the universal standard of what a university is and does for your future. But I would go out on a limb and say that the main determinant of happiness and success in life is not actually your career. It's not actually how well you do at your iBanking interview or whatnot. And that the main determining factor of satisfaction in life arguably comes down to your personal relationships, comes down to the success of your marriage, not the success of your iBanking interview. The good luck to those of you out there who I know are doing e-recruiting. That can lead to a certain other kind of success as well. So we're excited for this conference today because we think it'll address those issues that make you truly happy and that make you truly fulfilled. I had a pamphlet over break sitting in my backpack from Leon Cass. He's a University of Chicago professor, and he writes a lot about courtship. And I was given this pamphlet and told to read it, and like most things I'm told to read, it sat sort of on my floor over break, and now it looks like this. So I didn't read it until last night. And although even the True Love Revolution does not go out on the limb to defend courtship, there's a lot you can glean from Leon Cass. And so I want to read a little bit from it today. He says that in this culture, in this country where the divorce rate is 50%, very little attention is being paid to what makes for marital success. Still less are we attending to the ways and the mores of entering into marriage, that is, to wooing or courtship. There is, of course, good reason for this neglect. The very terms wooing, courting, suitors are archaic, and even True Love Revolution doesn't use those words. But today there is no socially prescribed forms of conduct that help young men and women in the direction of matrimony. This is true not just for the lower or under classes, even, indeed, especially the elite. Those who, in previous generations, would have defined the conventions in these matters lack a cultural script for marriage. Most of America's middle and upper class youth, the privileged, college educated, and graduated, there are no known explicit or even tacit social paths directed at marriage. People still get married, though later, less frequently, more hesitantly, and by and large, less successfully. For the great majority, the way to the altar is uncharted territory. It's every couple on its own bottom, without a compass, often without a goal. Those who reach the altar seem to have stumbled upon it by accident. But later on he says, never mind wooing, today's collegians do not even make dates or other forward-looking commitments to see one another. In this, as in so many other ways, they reveal their blindness to the meaning of the passing of time. Those very few who do couple off seriously and get married upon graduation are considered as freaks. And with that, I want to introduce our speaker today. We're very excited to have Dr. Woo! John Banna. Woo! And yeah, if you want to just fill in the sides, that's great. After John Banna speaks, we're going to open it up to question and answers, and I will moderate that. My roommates and I, actually this fall, we were on Google Books on a weekend night. I'm sure other people do that too. And we stumbled across Dr. John Van Epp's book, How to Avoid Falling in Love with a Jerk. And we sat in our common room and read over different passages. And I am so excited to actually finally meet him in person. Dr. John Van Epp is the president and founder of Love Thinks, LLC, and he is the author of How to Avoid Falling in Love with a Jerk. His book and popular relationship courses have been featured in the Wall Street Journal, Time Magazine, Psychology Today, O Magazine, and Cosmopolitan, and he has appeared on the CBS Early Show, The O'Reilly Factor, Fox News, Focus on the Family, the list goes on. He's even more popular than us. I asked him today what his favorite animal was. He says he has two new Shih Tzu puppies. I should say, I can't even pronounce it. So will you all help welcoming Dr. John Van Epp?
Thank you. Are you gonna stay up here with me?
Yeah.
Oh. I'm warning you, that's dangerous to do that. If you're gonna do that. Actually, it makes me nervous.
I can go, I can sit down.
You can stay if you want. They're just gonna look at you the whole time. It's almost an oxymoron. It's gonna be like love and fidelity, and she's gonna sit up here, and do you wanna stay here? Do you wanna sit down? Why don't you go sit down? Go sit down. Go relax. Get a cup of coffee. Come on. How are y'all doing today? If you're in a row that has a lot of gap in the middle, if you just move over a couple seats, just in case some people come in a little late, that'd be helpful. No, I'll do it at once, you know. Okay, thank you very, very much for not moving. Okay, let me see if this works. Got it. So how are you doing? Good. I'm going to go for about an hour of presentation here. And we'll have a little bit of interaction, but then most of our discussion, any types of things that you want to talk about, ask about, will be afterwards. So I have a little bit of time where I'll just ask you some questions, but for the most part, question and answer will be at the end of the hour and so forth. I appreciate the introduction. It's always feels odd to be introduced like that. You know, I started this actually 15 years ago because of working with so many couples that had been in a relationship, been very disheartened by that relationship, ended up getting out of the relationship, trying to start over and wanting to do it differently, but having no sense of how to do it differently, no real education in the specific area of choosing a partner, of building a relationship. And so what we're gonna go through is an overview of the entire book. I'm gonna just kind of sketch it a little bit and give you a brief, you might say, on it. And then I'm also would point out that the book is actually based on a curriculum that is taught. It's taught in all different age frames. It's taught in adult settings. In fact, 15 years ago when I first began, you know, I really wanted to reach parents. I figured if parents could teach their kids a little differently about relationships, we might have, you know, might take a couple generations, but we might have a real difference because parents are so much at loss. So it used to be called everything that parents should teach and singles should know about how to avoid, at that time it was called how to avoid marrying a jerk. How many parents do you think would come out to my seminars? Just guess.
Five.
No, less.
None.
There you go. Okay, good. You're right on. By the way, we got a stats major in the group. So here we are. Zero parents are coming out. So then I started doing, you know, extra large font. Everything that parents should know and or should teach and single, you know, everything else was a little font. Still no parents. No kids would come out. No high school kids. No college age would come out. The only ones that would come out were usually coerced by their parents. Sometimes paid off, I think, to actually come. And they would sit there and they would just look at me like, this is really stupid. We haven't even started, and it's so stupid that I'm even here. That would be a junior hire. My most frightening tour was in Georgia. I went did assemblies at the different junior highs throughout different regions of Georgia. And if you've never spoken to 500 to 1,000 12-year-olds about sex and relationships, what I learned was never ask a rhetorical question. I remember I was asking this question with them, and I was it was about 800 in the auditorium, and I was talking to them, and I was talking about this model, which I'll introduce you to at some point. But I said, girls, come on, How long does it take to really get to know a boy? Well, it was a rhetorical question. You're not supposed to answer those questions. But this 12-year-old in the front row, she was, I think, the leader of the entire school system. And she pipes up as loud as can be when I said, how long does it take to get to know a boy? She goes, 3 days. You got to think on your feet at that moment because you really can't get to know somebody in 3 days. But I said, you know, you are, I think, the most discerning, bright young woman in the entire school system. You can meet a boy and in 3 days you know him. So let me ask the group again, how long does it take to trust a boy, the same girl? 30 years. I was like, okay, out of the mouth of babes comes a little bit of wisdom there. So, but I think, you know, we're going to be talking about a couple different areas. So let me just begin by introduction. We'll kind of go slow. We'll get a general introduction to all this. Then we'll start bringing some of the theory and things into it. But we'll try to give you a good dose of where we're talking in terms of theory, academic research. But for the most part, I just want to give you a sketch. The book was published by McGraw-Hill, and one of my conditions was to be able to document any research that we were referring to. You know, I hate reading a book. I don't know if you've ever done this. And you read something and you say, you know, according to the Census Bureau, blah, 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 blah. And you read it and you're like, oh, that's pretty interesting. Yeah. Where did they find this? You know, and they don't really tell you, just some nebulous, you know, quote out there. So a lot of the things that we refer to in today, and if you read the book, you'll see that in the back, it's all footnoted, and so it's all documented. And for me, that was very important. But it's written how I tend to speak to you, which is a little more, just might say, street language. I think the starting point of this whole thing, can we get my PowerPoint up? Oh, we turned it off. That's what they do to me. Your hour's up. Beep. All of a sudden, the sound goes off, everything. The starting point, I think, is this disclaimer, you know? The disclaimer is this. Jerks have no gender, okay? Both males and females can be jerks. And we got a lot of females in the group, so I definitely won't call on the guys for a minute, but just let me ask the females. Have you ever known another female that you tried to get along with for a while, and she kept testing your ability to actually get along with her? And after a while, you just kind of shook your head and you said, you know what, I've been trying and trying for months, but she is just one royal Jerkette. Wasn't that the word you thought of? Jerkette. See, that's the politically correct term. Well, if you look up in Webster's Dictionary, the reality is that even the word jerk is gender neutral. We sometimes think of guys, and in no way is this saying, you know, guys are jerks, and, you know, the poor girls, they all, you know. We've all seen a really decent guy that has been in a relationship with a female that we all kind of shake our head and we go, why are we wasting this good male material on her? I mean, you've seen that. We've seen it both ways. So the starting point is going to be like there's some people that are truly difficult to be in a relationship with. So you help me out here. How many of you have ever been in a relationship with somebody that's difficult to be in a relationship with? Come on, raise your hand. Come on, raise. Okay, so some of you. Okay, so how many of you have ever known somebody that's been in a relationship with somebody that you'd say is a real jerk? Okay, so what's one characteristic? Let's just make a little list here of some of the things that characterize a person that's very tough to be in a relationship with. What's one?
Selfish.
Okay. Selfish. What's another?
Stubborn.
You know, you this is kind of flowing now. Okay, anything else you think of?
Insecure.
Say again, I'm sorry.
Insecure.
Not running out of room. All right, let me just stop there for a minute. And this might be a little bit humbling, but I need to ask this. How many of you at one time or another in a relationship, how many of you been in a relationship? How many of you were born to parents? I just want to see if you're actually raising your hand.
It's like, born to parents or not? I usually don't refer to them as parents. Thing one and thing,
okay. So, no, you love your parents or your caregivers or whoever raised you, I'm sure. Anyway, off topic, right? Let's get back on. Humbling question, though, I want to ask you this. How many of you at one time or another in a relationship, whatever relationship, have been a bit selfish? Raise your hand. Okay, so some of you. How about inflexible? Same people. Food. And the rest in the group are liars. So, this is my question. You know, it's a sobering question, but what is the difference between acting like a jerk and being a jerk? Anybody have a thought on that? That's not a rhetorical question, by the way. Everybody's like, oh, don't ever answer his questions. We'll be like a junior high girl. What is the difference? What's somebody, give me an idea. What's the difference between acting like a jerk and being a jerk?
3 days.
3 days. That's right. All right, I think I know what you mean, but can you explain it? What do you mean by 3 days?
Consistency, patterns.
Consistency, patterns, very, very good. Where do you go to school?
MIT.
It shows, that's right. It's like, when he dates, he's like, you're an engineer. He dates, it's like, I've noticed that you've done that 4 out of 8 times that we've been together, which I'm very big on, and I would say, I'm going to write down the word patterns. Is there anything else that anybody thinks of that is a distinguisher between acting like a jerk and being a jerk? Yeah, here in the front row.
Denial.
Okay, what?
The inability to apologize if I meant you were wrong.
Okay, very good. Like you don't really see it. So lack of insight, lack of, okay. So patterns, inability to really recognize the issues that you have.
Motive,
okay, so who said motive, Adrian? Okay, thank you. Like, what are you thinking about?
Sometimes you're selfish without meaning to be, or you don't recognize, that's driving, like a driving force, and other times, people really are driven by their flexibility.
I know what you're saying.
You get caught up in things, and for a moment you're selfish, so it's a pattern, I guess, again,
but it's a good point that some people are more intentional about what they are, they're stubborn and they're proud of it. Do you know somebody, somebody that has an anger problem? They're like, yeah. Yeah, my dad had an anger problem. And my grandfather before me, it's a part of the McCoy family. I call that pride of pathology. Do you know when somebody's proud of their pathology? I don't really have a lot to be proud of. I do have a pathology. But that's the kind of thing, is that it's some people, did you ever know the person that actually sees their issue and they're all sorry about it? I'm so sorry. Me too. And then 3 days later, the pride of pathology comes out. Yeah, I said I was sorry. I keep throwing it on my face. Okay, so I did it again. Okay, I'm sorry again. I'll tell you what, I'll write you a note, I'm sorry, and then every time I do it, just pull it out and read it, okay? So the core difference here at the bottom, I say, it's a persistent resistance to change, whether they see it or don't see it, whether they're in denial, right? I'm going to show you a little movie clip here from one of my favorite movies. Let me just see if this is on or off. There we go. Okay, I think that's on. Hopefully everything's good here. But it's from a movie, Jerry Maguire. How many of you have ever seen Jerry Maguire? All right, good. If you've seen it, I'll just remind you if you haven't seen it. It's a little clip where Jerry's in a relationship with a woman, and I want you to watch her, because I think she has a little bit of issues, we'll say. And I first want you to decide what her issues are, and then second of all, did she have that persistent resistance to change? Was it something that she was going to deal with? Something that she was going to address, or is it something that's going to be a pervasive problem in their relationship. And if they got married, you know, are those issues going to go away? Are they going to get magnified? What exactly is going to happen? So anyway, Jerry is a sports agent. And this is in the beginning of the movie. He's kind of run by guilt about being really manipulative of the athletes and not giving them a fair shake. And so he writes an ethics statement or a mission statement at work, which leads to him losing his job, which she makes reference to when she says, "I didn't screw up both of our lives." She's referring to the fact that he wrote this mission statement, which was kind of a good thing, you know? It was like almost like he was trying to be a stand-up guy in a world where there's a lot of money and manipulation and using people. And so anyway, not that in the movie he doesn't have his own issues, but I want you to analyze her, okay? And what her issues are, and whether you think she's gonna change or not.
Jerry, you and I are salespeople. We sell. It's not lovely. It's not shop manager. It's make the sale. Get it signed. There shouldn't be confusion about that.
Just
jump right in when I've been in the
large one. Oh, so honesty is out loud here. I can't be honest.
Anyway, I would prefer.
What was our deal when we first got together? Brutal truth. Remember?
I think you added brutal.
Jerry, there is a sensitivity thing that some people have. I don't have it. I don't cry at movies. I don't gush over names. I don't start celebrating Christmas by one early, and I don't tell a man who just screwed up both our lives. Oh, poor baby. That's me, for better or worse. But I do love you. Nope.
It's over.
Didn't hear it.
There's something missing here, don't you think?
You have never been alone.
Listen to me.
And you can't be alone.
It's over.
No one has ever dumped me.
I'm not trying to make history here.
I did the 23-hour nose route to the top of El Capitan in 18 hours and 23 minutes. I can make this work. Jerry, I drew strong for you, loser.
All right. I was thinking he needs a little skill training.
A little jiu-jitsu skill, self-defense.
Well, you know, in all seriousness, okay, what do you think her issues are? What was that? Pride, yeah, she seemed pretty cocky. You might say, but pretty proud. Yeah, what other issues?
Controlling.
What did you see that made you think, oh, she's kind of controlling?
Well, she said, like, oh, I did this in 18 hours, whatever, I can make this work.
Yeah, yeah, I climbed El Capitan, you know, out of Yosemite, right? Which is a big to-do. And how many, yeah, and I think, interestingly enough, it was almost like, I can do this relationship with your help or without it. I can make this work. All you need to do is sit on the sideline. Some people are like that, you know. Some people are really well-meaning and they're like that, you know. You got problems, but don't worry. I can solve all your problems. I can fix it. I've read books about you. In fact, I have a library in my house about you and your problems. You know, I'm going to college now. I'm minoring in your problems. I mean, some people are really good-hearted and they're trying to do these things, but she was a little more proud, cocky about her issues. What? Anything else you saw about her? You know, I know it was a humorous little scene where she punches him out at the end, but in all seriousness, if he got married to her, do you think she would be violent in that marriage? The strongest predictor of future violence is what? Previous violence. Somebody smacks you around, don't rationalize it. And it's interesting what prompted her to hit him, you know, in her own mind. Did you hear what he whispered to her? I never meant to hurt you, which I mean, that was really one of her major issues, is that she could not just be intimate. You know, she couldn't be sensitive. And that pride of pathology, did you see that with her? When she was slamming those books around, you know? One other thing that I just mentioned that I thought was kind of interesting, this I've seen so often in relationships, when she said, you know, I am not sensitive. I don't cry at movies. I don't gush over babies. I don't prepare for Christmas 5 months early. She slammed these books around. She grabs his shoulder. She goes, but I do what? Love you. This is a huge point of confusion that I just want you to make note of. Love does not alter the essence of the person who's loving you. Just because they love you doesn't fix them. You'll hear a lot of people say that. They'll be like, you know, I know that she's got these issues. I know that she's got that. Or I know they come from this kind of a family. They got all these unresolved stuff. But you don't understand. She really loves me. Or I know he's got this stuff. I mean, I know that he does. I know he acts this way. But you don't understand. In his heart, I know it. I know he's really, truly in love with me. As if love fixes you. And love can motivate you. But was love going to fix her? If he married her, what would she be like? Yeah, what you see is what you get. So keep that in mind. True confessions, you know, I asked you if any of you had been in a relationship. Now, I got a couple rules. All right, I'm going to ask you to just give a very brief, that's rule number one, keep it brief, experience that you had in a relationship that we'll call a dating disaster. You know, either a relationship with somebody that had issues. Rule number two is you got to keep it clean and appropriate. Okay, you can't be like, you know, this. I dated this person and, you know, I found out that they've been murdering people. And, you know, just keep it, like, simple and clean and appropriate. And number three, it can't be somebody in the room. You know, you can't be like, yeah, I dated some George. I don't want to say too much about George. Yeah, just something. Somebody's got some story. Somebody that was very difficult to be like, come on, we got to have a volunteer somewhere. Open up. God, this is uncomfortable. Is he just going to look at us forever? Nobody's had a dating disaster? Nobody's had a relationship with somebody? You look back, you're like, wow. You do. You're laughing. Nervous laughter is always a dead giveaway. Yes, ma'am. Okay.
But what's wrong with that?
Just kidding. Well, let me see, stand up for a minute. I think anybody that is going to share definitely should get a free t-shirt. So, can I throw it to you?
Yeah.
Okay, ready? Oh, gotta give it up. Would anybody else would be willing to share real quickly? You had bottles thrown at you and anything else? Come on, we gotta have one more. I can't go on one story. Okay.
I got a large t-shirt here. Yep, go ahead, sir.
I was dating this girl for about a year and a half, and we had gone through a really rocky part in our relationship, and where like things were really up in the air, but we were kind of still trying to stick with it and work with it. And I just remember one night I said to her, like, when you say you love me, what do you mean by that? And she said, just like off the cuff, like, I don't know. And like just that unwillingness to, you know, to engage or to meet, to try to recognize that there's a problem and go forward. But just, yeah, just that difficulty.
Do you mind if I share?
Yeah. You definitely deserve a t-shirt and a book. Because when she says, I don't know. You'd be like, well, I have a book for you to read. You can take it on dates from now on. You know, you can have it in your hip pocket. You can sit down. You can be like, we'll order appetizer. Yeah, it's very good. Yes, we'll have that appetizer. Thank you. "Huh, it's really nice to meet you. So where are you from?" Mm-hmm. Well, I actually attended a conference, and there was an author there that had a book full of questions to talk about to determine, how you get to know each other, what you think of each other, and I just happened to have it in my pocket. See how good that is? So come on, can we pass this back? I don't know how to get it back there. If you can run it back there to him. But let me ask you this: a year and a half, did you see warning signals that she wasn't willing to get real personal, wasn't willing to really open up, or whatever it was? Did you see warning signals?
I would say maybe a month or two prior to that I started seeing signals, but the year before that, I would say no. The first year, really, there was like real active engagement, but then there were some external circumstances that had been happening, and that was what was causing the difficulty. But
you know, that experience is like really, really common,
just so you know. And it's often referred to as love is blind. And I think that there's definitely a certain amount of time that it takes to be able to see warning signals. But I saw this, I've been doing therapy for about 28 years, and from the very beginning, I was very interested in romantic relationships, romantic attachment. I had developed this model way back in the 80s, and have been using it ever since in both therapy. I taught grad school, both in psychology, counseling departments, marriage and family courses, and use this model a lot in that as well. And then just individually, but way back early on, I would talk to someone that was kind of saying that, and they were in a relationship for an extended period of time, and I would ask them, sitting here now, looking back at the beginning, can you now look back and see some things that, were red flags in the relationship? And almost always people are like, at some point in time in the relationship, they saw red flags. And a lot of times they saw red flags way back in the beginning. And so I would say to them, at the time, way back in the beginning, did you see those red flags? And the first answer I heard over and over was this one. No, I didn't see them. But man, if only I knew then what I know now. I heard that over and over and over. Almost like people that say, been there, done that. They would say, there are things that I didn't know. I didn't get to know about them, or I didn't look at. And the other answer that I heard over and over was, I saw some warning signals, like little red flags, but I just overlooked them because I was too much what? I said the right word, but you didn't pronounce it correctly. You got to pronounce the vowel for 5 seconds, so let's all do it together. I was too much in. There you go. That's what it sounds like. And love is intoxicating, but I would also say love's supposed to be intoxicating. I mean, when I met my wife for the first time, we've been married now for a little over 30 years, and I met her, thank you. Thank you. Yeah, she died 25 years ago, but I just kept her alive. No, I'm kidding. How did you make your marriage last? I killed her. Stuffed her. She doesn't argue a bit. No. She's very much alive. I could call her, but she's not feeling real good. She's stuck in Ohio, but we're getting that big snowstorm from Ohio all the way down to a little south of you. You guys are fortunate you missed it. But anyway, we've been married for a long time, but when I met her, I was very shy. I had come out of high school, went to a college, and I transferred to a inner city college in the city of Philadelphia, actually, and I was very, very attracted to her. I mean, I was like, I was obsessed, okay, I'll admit it, and I was shy, and shy boys don't go up and make conversation with girls, so I just watched her, like, for 6 weeks, I would see her on campus in the city, and I'd watch her, and I bought a pair of binoculars, okay, telescope. I did not do that. Guys are, man, he's really weird. No, I didn't do that. But I would stand by, and I'd watch all these, she was very outgoing and very gregarious, and I'd watch all these people talk to her until I decided a way to meet her, and how I met her. It's hard being a shy boy. I'm not nearly as shy as I was back then. She's rubbed off on me, which is part of what happens in marriage. You don't always marry somebody that's exactly like you. I would have gone out and married an introvert, and us two introverts could have sat around and introverted. that would have been cool. So I married this most outgoing, I think she was the most outgoing female on campus. She was a freshman, I was a sophomore transferring in, she was a freshman, and she was really outgoing. And so there was about a block and a half between two of the buildings. And I left one building, I came down a half a block, and I was crossing the street, and the second building was way at the end of the block. And so I had another block to go, and I happened to just be standing there at the light, you know, I look behind me, and I see a half a block behind me, you know, all these other students are coming down, and they're surely, you know, tootling down with these students. And so tootling, that's a, mark that one down, be like, hey, haven't heard that word since my grandparents died. She starts walking. You know how students are walking from one facility to the other. You know, they're all walking real fast. So everybody's like, it's like the cows going home on the farm type of thing. Everybody's rushing. And so I figured the only way that a shy boy could meet a girl is through an accident. So I walked very slowly, and I would look at, it was ridiculous. What do you do? How do you walk a city block slowly? Cigarette butts, I mean, you know. I remember the Wawa grocery store, it's just like a little chain. And I remember reading the sign, milk is on sale. You know, all the students probably wondering, why does John, he really likes milk. Wow. And I get down to the door of the Robert Morris building, and I'm opening the door, and I walk so slowly that I see on my peripheral vision, I see Shirley is right there. I knew her name, you know, she didn't know anything about me. So I open the door and kind of like usher her in. And her first words as she walks by and she looks at me and she goes, man, you walk slowly. There you go. Now, I didn't hear her say that, actually. What I heard her say was, I'm in love with you. That's how delusional young boys function. Yeah, you know, she talked to me, she noticed me, she's in love. So, I mean, that started it. We became best friends and hung out, and part of what she was attracted to me was how, you know, I was different than the other kids, you know, because I was shy and quiet, and I needed to be fixed, and so she was helpful, but, you know, she was helpful in fixing. But the reality is, when I look back at that two-year period of dating before we got married, there was a lot of things that we got to know. Somebody can use and help me here. I don't know why it goes off and on, but is it on a timer?
It's cool that you do this.
What do I need to do? Tell me.
Or no.
Where's that bottle? What? Okay, show me what you did so I just know. Oh, okay. Got it. Okay. Talking about. So Shirley and I got to know each other, and but looking back, you know, at that early time, I would say a lot of what we got to know really helped us deepen an understanding of each other. And when we made a transition into marriage, honestly, I don't remember for the first year, you know, figuring like, geez, I didn't know this about her. None of that really happened. But so many people look back and are lacking what I call head knowledge. So if you want kind of a clinical definition of what the love is blind experience is all about, I would say it comes from one of these two areas, either a lack of head knowledge or a lack of heart knowledge. And we're not saying that you aren't supposed to fall in love, which was kind of the whole purpose of me telling you that story, is that I was madly in love with her. I didn't even know her. But is it possible to fall in love with somebody and get to know them and be like, wow, I can't believe I had any feelings for you beginning. This is embarrassing. I mean, is that possible? You know, that chemistry doesn't always last. I know a lot of people that have that. You know, in studies that I've done within the first 3 months, it's like 75% of people break up. So something got them together in the beginning, some kind of attraction, chemistry, you know, feeling, that as they got to know each other, they decided to break up. But the key is that there's a lot of relationships that you get into where your head and your heart are not working together. And so we're gonna kind of talk about that, the balance of how the head and the heart should work together. And the head knowledge, if you look at this model, this kind of summarizes the whole thing. Head knowledge would be on probably which side, the right or the left? What your mind is, getting to... Okay, good. So your mental involvement is getting to know somebody. So we're gonna talk about, at the end of this presentation, I'm gonna kind of quickly give you five areas to get to know, and I'll just maybe tell you a couple examples of them, but we'll spend most of our time kind of building up to that. And so five areas to get to know. So if you think about like a drop-down box, what am I getting to know about somebody? I'm getting to know these five areas. And they're going to spell an acronym FACES, so it's kind of easy to remember. But the rest of this model talks about the heart knowledge. And the idea is this, is that you can determine how much trust you put into another person. Now, nobody tells you how much to trust somebody. You determine that. But the thing is that I have found people don't really think about measuring the amount of trust they put into a relationship. They just kind of go with the flow, you know? But in a new relationship, it's very exciting and engaging, and so it's very likely that your trust is going to go way up even though you only know them this far, right? So it's very exciting and invigorating, but it's also very risky to get these levels out of balance. We determine how much we depend on somebody and look to them to meet our needs, or how much commitment we have, or how far we go in any type of sexual interaction. All those things are our choices. No matter what your values are, no matter what you think, those are your choices, and people don't dictate them for you. You dictate them for yourself. So this whole model is saying, listen, this is a picture of how your head and your heart should work together. Now let me give you just the theoretical side of it all. There's two theoretical constructs that go behind all of this. So if you're in a program like a marriage and family program or a psychology program or just thinking about this in general, the first theoretical construct is partner selection. You know, we have come from a world where arranged marriages dominated almost all societies throughout all of history, right? If you just go back even 100 years ago, you had no such thing as dating. In fact, the term dating, do you know what decade that term started to be used? Prior to that, it wasn't even used. A little earlier. 20s. A little later. Split the difference. 40s. There we go. Got it. We got another stats major in the room. Just kind of play with the numbers. We got it. So you're right. In the 40s, and prior to that, was courtship. And prior to courtship was arranged marriages. And that's when families are doing the arranging, right? You know, and I'm not saying that this is the right way to do it, but I am just saying that in the 1900s, and it was building actually since the late, say, 1600s, the Age of Enlightenment and so forth, 15, 1600s, and you got into the 17, 1800s and the Romantic era. Things are changing. But in the 1900s, it really began to sweep Western culture, began to impact Eastern culture as well, this whole concept of doing relationships before marriage differently. And marrying for love. And you have a lot of sociologists that have written about this and so forth. But, you know, I'm just being descriptive. Before that, it was always guided by families, you know? Why were families so interested in who you married? What do they care? What?
Money.
Yeah, social status and money. Those are two things. And why else? They love you, and there's also a little bit of a selfish reason. Whoever you marry, you not only marry an individual, you marry their. And so their family becomes your family in a lot of ways. Do you guys understand that? When you marry somebody, you do not just marry an individual. You marry the family members. They'll probably move into your basement with the economy the way it is. So look around. You marry genetics. Check out Uncle Fester. Just remember when you get that little baby, that beautiful face of your partner is not necessarily the face that's going to be on that little baby. It could be, oh my God, it's Uncle Fester. A little miniature body. Right? You marry genetics, and you marry the psychological family. They got a family inside of them. After a while, you marry this woman, and you think to yourself, you know you never got along with your father, and I thought that was because you're so much not like your father, but now I realize I married your father. I know I married your father, but if I say to you, you're acting like your father, then you act like your father even more. Okay, so we marry families. And so families knew that families marry families, and they tried to guide the process, right? This was all going on. You're all on your own now. Now, some of you might have families that guide the process, but almost everybody, especially those that are single again, you know, from singles and we're delaying marriage, so you're older and your families are not in the picture, and you're an adult now. You're an adult at age 11, you know. You're on your own. Figure out what you want to do and who you want to do it with. I don't know. Don't even talk to me. I screwed up my life too much. I'm not a good source. And we have a lot of parents that are all screwed up. And so you're on your own, and off you go. And so we're a very, very individualized society. That's the prominent current of relationships and how we think, and don't tell me what to do. You know, taboos now are taboos. It used to be that there were taboos. I remember my dad, who passed away a few years ago, but when he was growing up, you know, he grew up and attended, you know, in Cleveland Heights, Ohio, went to school systems there in the 20s and early 30s, and went off to World War II to fight for our country, and, you know, he was part of that era. I mean, gosh, if he did half of the things that we do today, he would probably be arrested. There were taboos. Now the basic taboo we have is don't have a taboo. It's taboo to have taboos. You know, and you'll hear people do that. You'd be like, I don't really believe in this. You'd be like, you know what? Keep your opinion to yourself. If you don't believe in something, then you can just keep it to yourself. We are very free and can do whatever we want, society. So listen, this is no place for morals and ethics and convictions. I have a conviction about your convictions. Keep them to yourself. That's my conviction. Say, well, wait a minute, but you have a conviction. You know what? Don't be so judgmental. That's what's wrong with all of you. You have convictions and you're judgmental about it. So you know what I'm saying? I'm making light of it, but the reality is that when it comes to dating and relationships, nobody's going to really tell you what to do. There really is not much family guidance going on. Even your friends don't know. They'll be like, I don't know. I mean, I get called from Cosmopolitan Magazine and Men's Health on a regular basis. And the questions they ask me, I'm like, do you really need to ask this question? I remember getting a call from Cosmo, and they're like, because obviously about all female relationships. And so they're like, listen, you know, we're writing a story about if a woman, if she's dating a guy who has all his friends are like bad boys. They're messed up, you know, they've got bad relationships, blah, 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 blah. And he's kind of secretive about them. So when he goes with his friend, she's not included. Should she worry about this? I gotta really look into the research on this. I'm like, do you really need to write a story about this? I mean, is that how lost we tend to be in relationships? But we're also on our own, we get these hunches and intuition, and we're like, I don't know. And I was saying that good-hearted people are the greatest at risk, because I think if any of you are and you're fairly good-hearted, if somebody does something wrong in a relationship, what's the right thing to do? When they do something wrong and they say they're sorry, what's the right thing to do? Yeah, you don't keep score in the patterns. Be like, you know, that's the 53rd time. Pattern is established after maybe 5 or 6, but I've been pretty good-hearted here. So I'm going to the 10th power. You know what I'm saying is that we have relationships where if we're good-hearted and we're trying to do it right and we're trying to think the best of somebody, we don't really know what to do. We don't know how to pace them. We don't know. We hear all kinds of mixed messages. So the whole goal of what this course is about was to say, listen, we need to give people a grid, a way of doing partner selection. And I can tell you theoretically, I taught a lot of the coursework that I taught was assessment courses. Like, I call it psychological detectives. You sit down with somebody and you have to figure out what they're like. Did you ever see the movie Meet the Parents? Yeah. Remember the FBI or so? I don't know. It was FBI or CIA. What was he?
CIA,
remember? And he was all about doing psychological inventories. Well, that, you know, I'm into that stuff. So it's all about sitting down and figuring out somebody's life. And I remember teaching students all this stuff. And as I taught it, I read, you know, I like research, so I've read a ton of the research on what are predictors of what somebody's going to be like in the future, both as an individual, but particularly I did taught marriage and family assessment. So how to figure out what you're doing today that's going to predict what you're going to do tomorrow, that type of thing, predictors, okay? So as I was reading all this research, I thought, nobody's ever translated this into the world of singles. So that you can sit down and you can like make an assessment about somebody without giving them a battery of tests. You know, you can do it, like nobody teaches you what questions to ask or even what content areas to try to fill in. And that was a big part of what this book is all about. It goes through 5 major areas that summarize literally hundreds and hundreds of articles of research that say these are predictors of how a person is gonna be in marriage. Because I think, you know, you can't marry the perfect person. It's not nothing about that. But it is about getting to know the right stuff and dealing with the right things before you actually lock and seal the deal of the relationship and into a marriage. And feeling more confident in the process. I found a lot of people are so worried about it that they're not confident. But if I'm gonna learn what will predict what you're going to be like. Embedded in that is character development, because I'm also learning what I need to do to be a good partner. If I'm going to look at, this is what makes a good partner, then I'm also looking at, you know, for me, I got to look in the mirror a little bit. So partner selection, character development, and the last one is something that I don't think we have very much research on at all, comparatively. It kind of blows my mind. We have a ton of research on attachment theory, which goes from Ainsworth back to Bowlby and the different quadrants from Bartholomew and all about attachment styles. And in the 80s, they were applying all this to adult relationships and staying in the... But really what I'm going to present to you before we run out of time is a model that talks about the dynamics of what caused the attachments rather than attachment styles. So relationship development is all about how you pace a relationship. Are there healthy and unhealthy ways to have a relationship, to develop a relationship, and what does that look like? So I'm going to just introduce this model very quickly and say that this model represents, we're going to start with relationship development. So in those two, if I go back for a minute, I'm going to start from number two, develop it, and then go back to number one. Okay? So this model says that each of these five areas is bonding. It really summarizes not only a major source of relationship bond, how well you know each other, how well you trust, the degree that you depend on each other's needs, the degree that you are invested, you know, giving of yourself to the person, that's commitment. And then you also have, like, you might call it structural commitments, you know, like we're dating or we're engaged or we are actually married. These are, you know, aspects of commitment that are more structural rather than just heart-related or invisible or abstract. But you have all of that goes up into commitment and the investment that you're making to the person. And then your chemistry, your affection, how you touch them, and all of that. So these are five areas in and of themselves that are very, very bonding. In fact, I think, you know, some of you will, I'll put these all down at the bottom. Some of you have come into this day and you don't know something, you know, you don't know everybody in the room. And so you're going to meet somebody and you're going to start to get to know them. As you get to know somebody and you share things, does that potentially create a bond? Just getting to know somebody. Does that make sense? I'll give you a perfect example. I was flying out from Cleveland, Ohio, out to St. Louis, and I was going to speak at a graduate school, and I was teaching it all day. My course is a train the trainer, so I teach people to teach it. So, you know, we teach people in the community. I've been working with the military for 6 years, traveling around teaching people in the military to teach the course. I go down to the chaplain school. All the chaplains teach it. Even though it's not a religious course, it gives a lot of good, you know, fuel for them to use and talk about. And so I was going out to this university to teach these grad students so they'd be certified and they can teach it. And I sit down on the plane, and this woman sits next to me, and she's an extremely outgoing person. And I just happened to say to her, are you from Cleveland also? I'm from this area. Are you from this area? And where are you going? Just, you know, make a conversation. You know, I'm not trying to be nosy. And I think that's the last question I said to her. She goes, oh my gosh, I'm going out to St. Louis. My kids live out there. They moved from Cleveland out to St. Louis. They're both married. I haven't seen my grandbabies for 6-7 months. I am so excited to see them. I just can't tell you. And she starts shuffling through her purse, and she's looking for what? A photo album. She pulls out a photo album. She's just like, let me just show you my family. This is my son. This is when he was little. Doesn't he look a lot like his kids? This is his wife, and, you know, 30 minutes later, she's finishing up the photo album. I've met her old family. I'm getting to know her a lot. And there's that awkward moment where she realizes that all I said was, hi, where are you going? That's all I had said. And she just showed me her old family. So at any rate, she's like, I'm so sorry. I'm just a big talker. I'm so sorry. Who are you? So I introduced myself, and you know, told her, I said, I'm going out to teach this relationship course that I wrote. She goes, that's so interesting. What's the name of your course? And I'm like, well, you know, it's not the typical, like, educational title. It's called How to Avoid Marrying a Jerk. She's like, oh my gosh, where were you when I needed you? I've been married 5 times. So all of a sudden, there's like an hour left of the flight. And all I got to hear about the next hour, I just sat down, pulled out my legal pad, and started taking notes because I heard about relationship number one, marriage number one, relationship number two, and it all led up to this is where I am right now. So Needless to say, I got to know a lot more about her. And when we stood up to say goodbye, you know, after landing, what do you think she did when she said goodbye? Of course. Why? Did she know anything about me? My name. My book title. That's it. That's all she knew. And these are two-way streets, you know. You can know somebody and you can be known by them. You can trust them and you can be trusted by them. There's a reciprocity involved in each of these. You can depend on somebody and somebody can depend on you. And they're not always equal, right? You can know somebody a lot better than they know you. But the point is that even if it's a one-way street, there is some bond that's occurring from each of these. They have to put, probably the know is the one that you can't get to know somebody and be like, I don't like anything I get to know about them, and nothing else really goes. But for the most part, the potential of building a bond is contributed by each of these five areas on its own, and then interaction-wise. In fact, they interact with each other, right? Because as she got to know me, now she wasn't married anymore, she was out of her fifth marriage, and as she got to know me, what do you think was happening to her trust in me? Yeah, I mean, it was way up there. I mean, actually, she got to be known by me. She didn't know me, but you know what I'm saying. And you know, if I would have given her my cell phone number, what do you think she would have been doing? Calling me, texting me. Do you think I wanted that? You know, and I could see it in her eye. She was looking for number six. I could flash my ring to her, you know, I'd be like, yeah, my wife and I are really happy. So, you know, what are we saying? What I'm saying is that these things are very interactive. In fact, I'm going to suggest that there's a logic. You know, there's a logic to how these different areas grow together and move together. And it's kind of a simple general rule. And it just says something like this. Whenever one of them is higher than the previous, it starts to create risk. That there is a safe zone that relationships can develop in. As you get to know somebody in the right ways, it tells you how much you can, say it with me, how much you can?
Trust.
As you have a good developing knowledge of them and trust, you begin to test it out. Are they there for me? Do they meet my needs? Do they come around? You know, are they receptive to how I try to do things for them? Do we have a good reliance? Can I rely on them, and can they? Okay, you can. Talk. Can I? Good. So, and these three areas tell me how safe my investment is. You know, am I getting committed to somebody I know, trust, and rely? And they also tell me how safe it is for me to get sexually involved in any kind of capacity. What, you know, what's one obvious way that this is risky? If you don't know somebody very well, you don't trust them, you don't have any built trust, you don't have any time to test out your reliance, there's no commitment. Why is this a little bit risky? What's the obvious one?
They're gonna leave in the morning.
Well, so there could be an emotional risk. What could be another obvious one?
Physiological.
Sure, there could be all kinds of physical risks and so forth. And so, and you'd be like, well, you know, but I protect, we save, all these different things. But the reality is that even if you look at the research tends to show us each of these areas is very bonding. And they actually kind of come from a different, you know, function or capacity of the self. You know, your physical self, your mental self, your emotional self, your volitional self, and your sexual self all works together. You are a whole being, believe it or not. You know, sometimes when you're studying hard and everything, you get a little skitsy. You know what I mean? You know, like you look in the mirror and you're like, who am I? And you're like, I don't know anymore. I've been studying, you know, statistical analysis, or I've been involved in this chemistry class that all I am is a bunch of molecules fragmenting all over the room. So, I mean, sometimes you can lose track and you get a little skitsy, but the reality is everywhere you go, your whole being goes. You know, you can't, you know, love, sex, these things don't have lobotomies, you know? You don't, like, leave part of your being one place and then go another. So the safe zone simply says, if you want to build a relationship, and it's up to you, it's your choice, you know? That's why I say we're in a very individualized world. But it's up to you. If you want to build a relationship in a safe way, just know that these levels have to work together, and they play off of each other, and there's a logic to it. And, yeah, you can't stop, like, I met Shirley, you know, and my opinion of her, and at least my chemistry, I mean, I wasn't physically touching her, I was metaphysically touching her. So, you'd be like, ew, that's gross. goes, well, you don't understand, or you haven't been in love, because, man, that's how I felt, but I had to keep bringing things down. I'd be like, you know, I don't really know her. You know, you kind of talk yourself through it. You know, you kind of put, you know, reality checks and so forth, and you set some, you know, I set some boundaries on what we did together or where we went or how much we opened up as time went on, and those boundaries kept moving and changing. But the point is that when things grow in a safe zone, the whole foundation is different. The whole foundation is different. One of the most risky types of things we have going on today is what I call accelerated relationships, which are just one of these areas gets all out of balance with the other. This is probably one of the most common. You'd be like, oh, I think, you know, highly sexualized relationships are. But no, I'd say people meet somebody and they immediately believe something about them. If you look at the stats on date rapes, for example, you will see that so many times this is exactly what happens in date rape situations. Very, very often. And if you find people that get into a relationship and kind of get hooked into that relationship, they will go back to the beginning and you'd be like, well, at what point did you start, you know, really feeling good and comfortable in this relationship? And almost always it's within 1 month. But I say it takes like 90 days to start to see patterns. I mean, couldn't you date somebody for a month and never have a situation arise where they get mad at you? I mean, don't you think so? I mean, I could date somebody for, I mean, if I was single, I'm not saying I'm dating now. I'm just saying, if I was single, I could date somebody for a month and never get married. That's why I think you should take a class on how to get somebody pissed off at you on the first date. There you go. You know, you go out on a date with somebody, just tick them off. Be like, oh, it was just a test. I just wanted to see how you treat me when you got mad at me. You passed the test, you did pretty good. You know, I know I ran your Jaguar into the lamppost. Not so nice, but that's what the insurance is for, right? So, you know, you can't do that. That won't even work. It takes time for things to surface and start revealing themselves. And what we're saying is that, you know, you need to realize that getting to know somebody is locked in time to a certain extent. Believing in them goes all over the map. You know, on your first encounter with somebody, your belief in them can be all over depending on what's getting tapped into. But truly knowing them, locked in time. Proving out their reliability, locked in time. Sexual chemistry, ain't need no time for that one. Okay, so that's all over the map. But in all these areas, you need to choose how you're going to do it. I just want to give you a couple stats about relationship development. It is interesting that there's a dramatic increase in the years before first marriage. And the reason I point that out is back here, if you look here on the left, you see in 1965, even 1970, the age of first marriage was right around age 20 and 22 for men, which means that the amount of time that you would have in this single world of just like relationships and everything was only a number, you know, X number of years. Whereas now, and this is just back to 2005, we're at age 27 for men and 25 for women. And I point this out not to make any kind of a descriptive comment or prescriptive comment, just to point out that we are adding more and more years of adulthood, which can be good or bad, okay? It can be positive or negative. So the point is as you have more years, you might have more experience. So singles, if you do look at surveys about singles, there's more singles today than ever in history. In fact, we are this close to more than 50% head of households being single, and never in the history of any country, anywhere in the world, since we've been, you know, keeping census, you know, census data, has there ever been a society that has had more singles as head of the household than couples, married couples? And so we've really radically changed. And I just want you to see the context we're in. And singles are very, very hopeful about achieving a lasting and fulfilling marriage. More and more are putting marriage farther back on the horizons. They're waiting to get married at a later date. And so I just want to point out that I think that statistically, Timothy Heaton did a study in 2002 where he looked at age, because the idea that if you just wait to an older age to get married, it improves the marriage. Well, in his study, he found that there's a dramatic decrease. If you get married when you're like 16 years old or 15 years old, I think that is, then the likelihood of disruption of the marriage, meaning divorce, some kind of disruption, with age alone as a predictor is pretty high. So if any of you are 15, I would suggest, you know, don't get married yet. Okay, that's not real. But look at how dramatically it drops. And what's interesting is it does keep dropping age 31, but it almost levels out from age 21, 22, all the way to 26. And then it drops just a little bit. And I think that's really, really interesting because me, if you had asked me before I looked at this study, I probably would have said it looked like this. It looked like it just kept going down like that, like a straight line. You know, in fact, I could draw it out on here that I think most people kind of think it's linear, that the effect of age, just age alone, in predicting marital disruption, meaning divorce, that it's high risk for teens, and then it just keeps dropping lower and lower. And the older you are, so if you just wait until you die to get married, you'll never get divorced. So, but the idea is that, you know, if you just wait longer and longer and longer, and I know there's books out, I mean, I've been reading, I read a lot, so I've been reading a lot of books out that are specifically about, you know, waiting longer, and both for males, but particularly for females. But there's a number of researchers that predict that 20 years from now, even 30 years from now, that it may not be a linear line that's predicting it, like just wait longer and you do better. They predict that it might be curvilinear, that there's a high risk when you're really young, and then the risk drops down, and it's the lowest risk as you're entering into your, you know, early to mid-20s. But as you start passing, we'll say, 25, that the risk starts to go back up. And you say, well, why would the risk go up? Well, there's two areas that they question. One is that you engage in relationship activities that actually are known to heighten risk. It's kind of like you have more time on your hands, and you might make more mistakes. You say, well, I learned from my mistakes. Yeah, but that's not always true. You know, the divorce rate for those that have been married and then divorced and then get remarried, right? So they made a mistake, they had problems, whatever the word, but if you take the whole group of people that have been divorced and then get remarried, their divorce rate is significantly higher. It's like 68%. So it's 18% higher than the average for the first marriage. And you say, well, why is that? Well, I don't exactly know why. You know, that's always the question with research is what is causing that? But something that I would say is been there, done that does not always make you do it differently and give you better odds. Does that make sense? So don't think that relationship activities are not going to affect you in the future. And there may be a smaller pool of prospective partners maybe as you live longer. And there's a book out right now that's a very controversial book, and they're going to be making a movie of it, if I know right, called Marry Him. And it's kind of countering this, saying, listen, be careful of waiting too long, because if you wait too long, then all of a sudden, you know, you start having these problems. Now, I just want to address this one issue of, as time goes on, no matter what age you are when you get married, as time goes on, the activities that you do when you're single, are they going to have any effect on your marriage? That's the question I want to address for a minute in terms of relationship development. Does it even matter? You know, why does it matter? It's like, I'm single. I'm not married. That's down the road. I'm on the island of singlehood. I'm not on the mainland of marriage. Someday I'll get in the boat and we'll go across that deep, dark abyss to the island or to the mainland of marriage. And when I finally get to that mainland of marriage, then I'll grow up. Then I'll be serious. Then I'll do everything right. But right now, there is no, it's you and your convictions again. I don't like that. Why are you talking to me about this stuff even? So I'm gonna call it a couple different, I'm just gonna point out two different research studies that are very interesting. There's one study that looked at men, and it looked at women, and then the second study looked at men, the number of sexual partners and their risk of marital divorce. Okay, and what they found was, and this is an article from 2003 from Jay Teachman. These are not religious articles, just so you know. They're not from religious schools. He's at Western Washington University. He looked at data on 6,500 women who were married between 1970 and 1995 from the National Survey of Family Growth. Found there's indisputable connection between the number of sexual partners they had before marriage and the likelihood of getting divorced. He took into account and controlled for these different factors: similarities and differences of family background, socioeconomic characteristics, age, religion, race, culture, number of siblings, and many more characteristics. Still, what was interesting, the involvement with just one sexual partner other than her husband during the dating years raised her risk of divorce 3 times higher than those who had only had sex with just her husband. And so he kind of goes through the different number of sexual partners and how that alters the risk, and he charts it out and where the statistical significance is. Now, I point this out to say, listen, somebody did a study on this. Now, it's up to you to go into the study and see, you know, if you want to disagree with it, what exactly in this study you want to disagree with. But the point is that there is something that is a correlating factor between number of sexual partners and the risk of divorce. And he looked also at cohabitation and different things, and he found that actually the number of sexual partners was the strongest predictor of all of the different things that he looked at, and it was even stronger than cohabitation, which I found was very interesting as well. There's a second study that was done down here, you can see, by Richard White and others, and they went into, they were replicating a study that was done over in Europe. And so they went into a number of countries, I think it was four different countries, and using survey data from, it was four developing populations, they looked at men. And what they did, which was really interesting, is they looked at men in terms of their premarital conduct. And one of the things they looked at was number of sexual partners that these men had. And then they looked at, it wasn't divorce, they looked at infidelity. So it was, census data. It was all confidential, obviously, and it was asking the men in terms of how many sexual partners did they have before they got married. And then the second thing that they correlated that with was how many of these men had an act of infidelity in their marriage. So obviously all the men that they were interviewing were already married. And but this is what it looked like. It was the way the data laid out that I found really, really fascinating. They looked at those that had zero sexual partners as a group. And so they took, out of all these four different countries, all the men that they were looking at, they took all the men that said they had no sexual partners before they got married. And then they looked at what is the percentage of this group that had what they called EMI, extramarital infidelity, okay? And then they looked at, as a group, all of the men that had had one sexual partner before they got married. And then they asked this group, what is the percentage of EMI, extramarital infidelity? And then they said, to three, you're getting the point, right? They just kept going, four, nine. Now, what they found that was really interesting, at least to me as one who likes to read studies like this, is that there's a statistical difference, and you all know what statistical difference means. It means that when you look at it, the probability of this percentage from this percentage being different cannot be attributed to just chance alone. So there's a statistical difference between every group. So there was, but that kind of blew my mind because I'm like, oh, come on, whether you had one or two sexual partners before you got married, does it really make a difference in the percentage of outcome in extramarital affairs? But what they found in the study in these four different countries was that, yes, each group was statistically different from the other group. And then he found this other thing, that there, it looked like a stairway going up, that one sexual partner was a little higher of a percentage, a statistically different percentage than zero, two a little higher than one, three a little higher, four. And he got up to the number five, I think it was, and those men who had postponed sexual debut until age 20, that was another one of the factors they looked at, is when did you first start having sex? And they were less likely to report EMI than men with very younger reported ages of debut in all of the sites. In addition, men with five or more premarital sexual partners were significantly more likely to report EMI in all sites. So what he found was that each of these was, one step a little higher percentage-wise, and then when he got to five, it was a big leap. And I point both of these out to say this. In very simple language, what you do in Vegas, don't stay in Vegas. Okay, did you hear that? We've gotten into a mentality that until I get married, I live where? Until I get married, where do I live? In Vegas, baby! Vegas is where I live. And so what you do in Vegas stays in Vegas. And this is very, very misleading. When you look at research at what I call a relationship continuity, there is a pervasive myth, and it is a myth, that relationships have no continuity. That what I do at one point in time will have no impact on a later point in time. And the reality is that is very untrue. Research has shown over and over and over. If you marry somebody that has an alcohol problem, they probably will have what in your marriage? If you marry somebody that has had a history of drug abuse. Once they're married, they probably will have a continued drug use. You know, in other words, patterns that have occurred during my single years actually are programming my future patterns. This is just a reality of life. But we have somehow created a cognitive discontinuity, this relationship discontinuity, and we really need to debunk this myth and bring some of this research to light and say, listen, this is not to be discouraging, this is to be hopeful. Things you do today will impact tomorrow. What you do today will have a difference on your relationships in the future. So what are the areas to get to know? I know we need to take just a couple minutes, and then we're going to have some questions and answers. But let me just mention, these are five key areas that really summarize a lot of research. Get to know somebody's family background. My mom passed away when I was going into my sophomore year of high school. And I was the youngest of five in my family. You know, one of the areas we talk about getting to know is how people handle emotions in families and how love and affection is shown. And you know, how many of you came from what you'd say was a very lovingly demonstrative family? Okay? How many of you came from families that you'd say was kind of like lacking in terms of being demonstrative? They didn't say it, they're like, well, we don't raise our hands because we're not demonstrative. Figure that one out for yourself, Vanette. Well, you know, I had a mixed family. You know, I told you my dad grew up in the 30s, and you know, he was kind of his generation, so he didn't really say I love you. He didn't, you know, he wasn't the type to show it. And you know, I told you I was a quiet boy. I was kind of a probably a little bit insecure at some times of life. And I remember after mom died that you know, feeling this emptiness. My mom was very demonstrative. She was of a kind of an Irish Scottish background, and they both grew up in Cleveland. They actually lived six houses apart when they grew up and knew each other and got married. You know, into their early 20s before he went off to World War II. So he kind of lost his childhood sweetheart when she died. And, you know, like a good man of that era, do you think I ever saw him cry? You know, I didn't really see him grieve, I didn't really see anything. And I was missing that I love you and those hugs and the things that my dad just wasn't real comfortable doing. And I remember being very analytic back at that time. You know, I wrote a lot and analyzed a lot. And this won't surprise you much, but I like analyzed how to get my dad to say he loves me, you know. So I figured if I said it to him, he'd have to say it back, you know. Surely was not the first one I was trying to figure out in life. And so I was 15 years old, and I walked by my dad, and I said, hey, Dad, you know, I think I'm going to go to bed now. I'll never forget, he was reading the newspaper, and he looks over the newspaper, and he goes, okay, good night, John. And I said, you know, before I go to bed, I just wanted to say something. And there's that moment, you know, that moment, that real special moment. And I said, Dad, I love you. And he looked at me with that most awkward look on his face, like, what the hell did you just do? And he goes, me too. So I went to my bedroom, I thought about it, and my analytic reasoning, well, at least one of us is loved. I love him, and he loves himself, too. Wasn't what I was looking for, but there you go. So, I mean, it was so weird and awkward, you know, as a young boy to do that. I didn't approach him again. But he got married, and, you know, that 90-day probation period, he met a woman in the spring, married her within the 90 days. So he broke the rules of how to get to know somebody and build a relationship before you get married. He just met her. You know, I think that he was struggling with his own aloneness, and they really felt like they loved each other, and so they got married very quickly. And my two siblings, I had two that were married, and my two oldest siblings were married, but my brother and my sister had gone off to college. So, you know, if I look back on it, I'm like, wow, you know, they went to college literally days after mom died, came home to a stepmom. So our whole family constellation went through this, and you know, we figured out how to do it. She had four grown, or they weren't grown, but she had four children of her own, and there were five in my family, so we became a family of nine. We worked on that whole blending the family together. I'll never forget, we had a Vanup tradition. On every Thanksgiving, we'd have a Vanup football game. That was always what we did, you know, and we'd have friends come over and things. But then when we had the blended family, I remember the first year, it was probably 3 months after they had gotten married, and so 4 months, So we're going to have the football game. Well, we always, everybody plays, like the little kids and the girls and the guys, you know, and the women and, you know, the, yeah, everybody plays. Everybody goes out and plays football, like tag football. So I think we had a little penned up aggression. It's kind of like, you know, we're gonna play football. Let's play tackle this year. Yeah. Why don't we play the Fowler family against the Van Epp family? Yeah. Yeah. I'd be like, you know, blah, tsh, boop, blah. 5 years old, that'll teach you to try to break through the tackle. That's right, man. It was raining out. It was like one of those ugly, dark movies with the banging each other, throwing each other in the mud. We came in the house. After that, we really loved each other. But I went off to college after my dad and stepmom got married. And at that time of my young adulthood, I became really convinced I wanted to, you know, say I love you to my dad and give him, you know, I kind of had decided I want to be more demonstrative than my dad was. I want to be different. Now, let me ask you, do you have to do exactly what your parents did to you? Or can you make changes? Is it easy or hard to make changes?
Hard.
I think it's hard. I agree. But I made a determined effort. So every time I'd say goodbye to my dad, he'd reach out, shake my hand, I'd pull him, give a big bear hug, and be like, Dad, I love you. He'd look at me and go, me too. And off I'd go to college. I'd come home, you know. He'd reach out, shake my hand, I'd pull him, give a big bear hug, and be like, Dad, I love you. Sometimes I'd just hold him a real long time. You ever, you know, that awkward moment where it's like, it's getting uncomfortable. Really love you. But, you know, there came a point where my dad began saying, I love you too. And then out of the blue, he'd say, I love you. And he passed away in 2005. But in all seriousness, he walks into my house. And he had Parkinson's. So he had what you call the shuffle. You know, he didn't shake, but he would shuffle like this. And he walks in the door, and he sees me at the other end of the house. And he reaches out his hands, and he starts shuffling toward me. And like a half hour later, he was like, No, I didn't do that to him. No, I didn't do that. No, but you know, it changed me. You know, I became more, you need to work on your family issues. And if you're in a relationship dating somebody, look at their family stuff. Because their family stuff is going to be your stuff. That's just the way that relationships blend two people together. And that's how it's supposed to be. And I'm going to tell you something I really want you to mark down if you're the one taking notes or anything. Relationships are structures to promote growth and character. That's what relationships are supposed to be doing. They're supposed to be bringing stuff out about you that may be a little trustworthy and some things that may be a little bit untrustworthy that you need to deal with. And some ways that you don't meet somebody's needs. You know, you have to learn how to meet somebody's needs. We don't get in a relationship to not change. We get in relationships to grow, to be better people. And if relationship structures are done right, they really promote getting to know the right stuff, building a sense of being respectful and trustworthy, meeting another person's needs, and it develops all of the right stuff to have a good, lasting commitment as well as a satisfying, deep sexual relationship. I just want to, you know, mention maybe one other thing, you know, about compatibility potential and the conscience. It's amazing to me, you know, talking about structures to promote growth and character. We just don't teach people how to figure out another person's conscience. And I've got a real lighthearted story I'll tell you real quickly about my oldest daughter who's now married and living in Washington. And she's going to be in her apartment with her husband now for the next 2 weeks because of the snowstorm. But, you know, they're in the midst of all of that down there in Fairfax. And but when she was 15 years old, maybe, she went out on a date with a guy from high school. And it was a perfect lesson, a very simple kind of lighthearted lesson, okay? So don't be like, you know, oh my gosh, this is like deep information. But it was kind of lighthearted on how to figure out somebody's conscience. Because let me tell you, when you get married to somebody, you're marrying a conscience. And you better figure out how their conscience works, how well they are able to get out of their world into your world, how well they're able to monitor themselves when you're not around, because their conscience is going to determine a lot of your comfortability with trust. It's going to determine how you go about meeting each other's needs when life changes you and things just happen, and on and on and on. And so figuring out somebody's conscience, in fact, one of the most interesting research studies I ever read is listed in my book under the chapter on the conscience. from a series of studies that was done all the way back in the 1920s in the Terman, the Lewis Terman database. Lewis Terman was put in charge of taking the Alfred Binet IQ test at that time and revising it and updating it. And he worked at Stanford University. And he was awarded a grant in 1920, get this, for $20 million. Think what you can do with $20 million in 1920s. So he took about 1,500 some kids, and he gave them a battery of tests. And he one of the things that he measured was conscientiousness. It just, you know, why did he choose that? I don't know. But he gave them a whole battery of things to measure their IQ and their social functioning. One of the things to look at how they function as a little kid was how conscientious they were. You know, what type of ethics and morals they had, how much self-control that they exercised, and how they thought about others, things that you associate with conscientiousness. That's what he looked at. There were some researchers, the Terman database, by the way, followed those kids until the day they died. It's one of the largest, if not the largest, databases in the world on family histories and individual functioning. Every 5 to 7 years, they would contact them and they would give them another battery of tests. And when they finally got married, they would kind of do things and they took newspaper clippings and all kinds of stuff and they built this huge database. Well, some researchers went into this database and they said, I wonder what predicts people that stay married the longest. Actually, they were looking at age, who lives the longest. But in looking at age, they found what predicted those that stayed married the longest. And you know, it was that one measure of conscientiousness back when they were 11 years old. Had the strongest prediction for those that stayed married the longest. And I think we need to learn how to measure. So I'm going to give you a quick little story on how to measure somebody's conscience from my oldest daughter, Morgan, who's now happily married, but dated this boy, and this was her first date. Now, how many of you have ever gone on a first date? Okay, so most people in this room. So she's 15. She goes out on a date. They go to a movie. He parks. He's a couple years older, so he parks way at the, you know, it was pretty busy. It was a nice summer night. But when they came out of the movie theater, it was raining. So they're standing at the door, knowing that you got to walk all the way to the end of the parking lot, and it's pouring down rain. Now, females, I would just ask you, like, if you're standing at the door, are you thinking about anything getting wet? You know, it could be any number of things, right? It could be your hair, it could be what you're wearing, it could be anything. So it doesn't take a brain surgeon to figure that my daughter was standing there looking at him. And she came in the door that night when she came home. And she goes, you will not believe what happened. So, I mean, we lived for stories like that. I just got to tell you, we loved hearing. I mean, we raised kids just for entertainment factors alone. It's like, I'm a little bored. Are you a little bored? Yeah. Let's have a kid. That's a great idea. It stays on the cable bill and everything. That's very cool. So we just raised them for this. We live for that. So she's like, you will not believe what happened. So we're like, what, tell us. She's like, well, she was drenched wet also when she came home. She goes, I go standing at the door. It's pouring down rain, and I look at him. And at that moment, I'm looking at his eyes, you know, like we're having this nonverbal communication. Like he gets me. He knows me. He knows I don't want to get wet. And he looks at me and he goes, hey, I'll race you to the car. So, yeah, my daughter, she's a runner and everything. So she goes running to the car, you know. She gets to the car, she goes to open the door, and it's locked. So she's out there getting wet, and she sees it's at night now. The light comes on in the car, which means what? He got in the other side, the light goes off, then the light comes back on, which means it could have, or he turned it on, which is what it was, and she's cleaning the window. She goes, I cleaned the window, and you know what he's doing? He's combing his hair. Now, okay, stay with me. It's like a game show. Big deal or little deal? Or no deal? What would you say, big deal or little deal? That's because you're so judgmental. You are really judgmental people. It's all those convictions you got, it makes you very judgmental. See, good-hearted people, they think it's a big deal at the moment. But then why was he combing his hair? To look good for her. Aw, that's so sweet of him. So, if not, all of a sudden you go to bed and you wake up in the morning and the big deal looks like a little deal. So all of a sudden, it's not a, he calls, he says, you want to go out again? They go out again, so they start keep going out, All of that fun, loving, that we gave her that night, and they, oh, I'm sorry, honey. Now I've got to find a way to, channel all of my frustrations. My daughter is continuing to go out with this guy after this little deal, so I go into gun collecting. It becomes a big hole in the pocket for me. I don't know what I'm doing. I'm just going on and looking for new guns. I find myself looking at, well, I don't know why I now have an attraction to guns. I don't know what to do. So I've got two daughters. All of a sudden, I want guns, lots of guns. What's going on? But all of a sudden, the little deal. Now, this is what happens. A week later, she comes home and she got another boohoo story. We're like, well, what's going on? And she's all upset and she's all bummed out. And it's another little deal, right? And then the next week is another little deal. Pretty soon, these little deals start adding up. And they add up to reveal what? To reveal a big deal. I'm going to call it a major theme. And the major theme that came out was simply this. He always thinks... That was it. And it didn't take real long. It took longer than I had hoped, but it didn't take real long. And what it came down to was just this very thing, that we tried to teach our daughters, and if I would have had sons, I would have taught them, that part of a relationship is getting to know somebody. Part of getting to know, you get to know their family background. We had this rule ever since my oldest daughter was in fourth grade. You know what the rule was? If you like a boy, this is how this rule came about. You'll like this one. I go to pick her up from school when she was in fourth grade, and they had like little windows in the door, and I'm looking in at her, and I'm like this proud father. This is my oldest daughter. I'm like, aw, she's so cute. She came from me. I just love her. She's so cute. So I'm like looking at her. The bell rings. Who all circles around her like vultures? Boys. I'm like, ah! All these boys. Now, I figured we'd have to deal with, this type of relationships and everything in junior high. But like third, fourth grade? Holy cow. So I go home, I said to my wife, we need a summit meeting right now. We gotta figure out what we're gonna do. We're either gonna lock her up, maybe we could homeschool. No, we decided. Any boy that she liked, that liked her, we brought their family to our house. Huh. We'd invite them to dinner, they'd come over, we'd eat dinner with them, they'd be like... And afterwards, my daughter would be like, family's weird. We'd be like, darn straight, you better watch how weird that family is. The apple don't fall far from the tree, boy. So they learned to look at the family. But we actively taught them how to read somebody's conscience. How do they think? How do they run their own life? And we're like, oh, that's a 15-year-old that's immature. Yeah, but the point is that she was 15, he was 17, and at that time of his life, the major thing was that he always was thinking of himself first. And so she would address it with him and so forth. But relationships, if done right, become structures where some of those slips and immaturities or whatever they are. Don't think that it's just the 17-year-olds. All of a sudden you date that 52-year-old and you're like, you're still immature. He's like, no. I matured into my 30s. And then I regressed when I hit my 40s. And I haven't come back, so I'm still trying to work on coming back. The point is that relationships, when done right, should bring things to the surface, they get addressed, and they get work done. Compatibility, examples, look at how people act in other relationships. That will tell you a lot. And their skills. But we don't have time, and we're going to do some questions and answers. But let me just summarize by saying this. The heart and the mind were meant to work together. You are one being. You got a brain. You got a biology about you. And you got a mind that thinks. And you got a heart, and you got love, and you got a chemistry, and you get attraction, and you have emotional needs, or whatever kind of needs you've got. You've got relationship potential. But the point is that keep your head and heart working together. If you pace your relationships in a good way, and you know what to get to know, you know the areas to really get to know, then you will be much more empowered to follow your heart without losing your mind. So all that is, like I said, summarized in the book. And so I don't know what we want to do about questions. We've got a few minutes. So what kind of questions you all got? Good. Okay, we're done. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, the question is, because relationships that you form before marriage have their implications in how marriage is formed and what happens, should you always be dating people that you think are marriage material for you? That's a really good question. I think I would first probably say no, and then I would say yes, and I would kind of waver back and forth. So let me just be a little nebulous about it. I would say, there was a really interesting research article that came out in, I think it was 2008, so it's pretty new. And in fact, let me just see here, boom, that's the, I brought some of the, let me look, where is it? This one right here, Carol Willoughby Badger and McNamara Berry, these authors right here. So close yet so far away, the impact of varying marital horizons on emerging adulthood. It was in the Journal of Adolescent Research. And what year was it? 2007. Okay, sorry, I was reading wrong. That was a really, really interesting article, I think. It was one of the most intriguing that I've ever read. And what they had, I think it was four universities they did data collections at. So they tried to, you know, get something that wasn't just biased to a certain area of the country or a certain mindset. And basically what they looked at is, at different age cohorts, when the person thought that was the right age to get married, kind of like when should you like get serious and be considering being, you know, what age would marriage be acceptable to you? And so they looked, they kind of divided it into those that thought in the early 20s, like 22, 23 was acceptable, those that were in the mid 20s, 25, 26, and then those that were, I think, the end of the 20s and older. And then they looked at how the person was living their life. So all they were using as a dependent variable, the only thing they were using was a mental belief about when, you know, how they called it, how close marriage is on your horizon. Does that make sense? So they weren't looking at, you know, the person that says, oh, I ought to be thinking about marriage, you know, it could happen when I'm 22, 23. So yeah, you know, that could be okay. All right. Versus a person's like, no way. I'm not going to think about marriage until I'm 29 or 30. No way. So all it was a mental attitude, and they called it your marital horizon. And what they looked at was how people built dating relationships, their sexual activity, their drug and alcohol use, a number of different other variables that they looked at. And they found that people that had at least the idea of marriage closer on the horizon point built relationships significantly different than those that had it far off. Those that had it far off engaged in kind of like anything. So they didn't have many, they engaged in high-risk sexual relationships. They engaged in a lot more drugs and alcohol. And those that had marriage closer had significantly less of that. And I bring all that up because I would say, on the one hand, I think, you know, it's maybe a little bit too much to ask that we try to figure out if somebody's going to be a good partner before we even go out with them. I mean, that's like, then you're gonna have to like, you know, get their password and Google information about them and do all kinds of, you know, it gets ridiculous, you know. I've done it, it's just ridiculous. No, I haven't done it. I think it's too much to ask. But I do think that knowing that how you build relationships now and the things that you engage in are not only an experience of the moment, but they're shaping ways that you think and function, and they're going to carry on with you into adult relationships particularly. So kind of knowing that marriage is a horizon that's not too far off, even if you're in high school, just keeping that as part of, you know, I want a good marriage, you know, someday. But I'm not going to live my life as if everything that happens now is no. I think that is really, really important. And so from that standpoint, I would say people are helped when they put marriage back into dating. If that makes sense, if I use that little term. That they don't date with absolutely no connection to the future, as if life is in a bubble and it has absolutely no connection. But they know that what they're doing, what other people are doing, it all kind of goes together, and that these things play off of each other and they have future ramifications. I think that's what's really important. Yeah. Very good question. The question basically is, to what extent should we try to have both accountability as well as people working together, supporting it? I'm doing some of you may be familiar with the Smart Marriage Conference. It's a conference that is put on marriage and family every year. And I'm doing a keynote called It Takes a Village to Raise a Marriage, and it's pretty much addressing that. One of the advantages of my course in particular is that it has versions for every age group you can imagine, from junior high to high school versions to a college, actually a college for credit course that can be taught in different colleges, to and in all of those courses, it helps to get certified to a parent piece so that youth, I have some examples of this if you want to see any of the material. We put together a parent guide so that if youth are being taught, their parents can be taught, hey, this is what your kids are being taught. Well, there's a lot of single parents that come to, you know, a class for parents, and this is what we're going to teach your kids, and they're like, well, this is really wonderful, but where's my class? Because, you know, I've been single now for 2 years or 3 years or whatever, and, you know, I'd really enjoy taking a class. Like, well, we got an adult class in the community. So we have it in adult settings for youth all the way on up. And the idea is this. I think not only do we need to disseminate similar concepts across the age span, so this model is the curriculum. So that 50-year-old sees this model and says, hey, I should follow this model in my adult relationships. And then that 15-year-old sees this model. And then we try to, you might call it cross-fertilize, or you know, like a transgenerational educational approach, where bring in a college student that's 21 years old and have them talk to the 15-year-olds and say, hey, I follow, you know, I took this course in college and I follow this. And then bring the 52-year-old in and have them talk to the 15-year-olds. And the 15-year-olds will be like, oh, that's stupid. But if you get the right kind of person, they'll be like, listen, I'm following this in my life. Don't think that this is just something that you need to do for this period of time of life because you're immature and you can't think right. You know, a lot of people will tell you, oh, by age 50, you should have it all figured out and you can meet somebody and immediately figure them out. But listen, that is not what's happening in my world. You know, people are struggling to figure out relationships. They don't have a real good guidance system, and this provides a really good user-friendly model to think through relationships, what to get to know, as well as how to pace yourself. So my answer would be, I think that we need to teach at different age cohorts and then get them interacting. And it's not just young people that need to hear from the older people. Those 52-year-olds need to hear from the college students saying, listen, you know, don't think that just because you're in your 50s, that you have no consequences to, you know, letting your trust go way up. I can't tell you how many, I worked with a lot of divorced people in therapy. Can I tell you how many women and men, for a while, they're gonna have nothing to do with the relationships. That's usually what they're like. Like the woman will come in and be like, you know, I've got this course that I kind of wanted to talk to you about and maybe have you read and so forth on how to do a relationship differently. I am not gonna get into a relationship with any man. I'm like, well, I'm a man. And, I mean, I know this is a counseling relationship, but there is actually a relationship going on here. And then all of a sudden, you don't see them anymore. And where are they?
In a relationship with a man.
They're in a relationship. And they're going headstrong. And, you know, the third weekend, they're spending the weekend together, and they're going out to, you know, and they've got more money, they've got more freedom, they've got their own residences. I mean, they have all kinds of things that make it really easy to just have these levels change. And numerous people will come in somewhere between the third and the seventh or eighth week, you know, from the third week to the second end of the second month, going into the third month, and they're just totally wiped out because they got burned. and they made poor choices. So I guess what I'm saying is that I don't want you to think that age always brings wisdom. Sometimes when you've been there, done it wrong, you learn how to do it wrong better. And you need to stop and think exactly about how to do it differently. And man, if you watch, you know, just if you watch television and reality shows, and if you just watch the, what's going on in the world around us, the messages many, many times are just all about doing it in a way that is high risk and really painful and hurtful. And these shows minimize the hurt that really, I would just use Britney Spears as a perfect example of someone that shows you, with all the money and all the fame that she has, when her marriage, after several years, broke up, you know, with Kevin Federline, look what happened to her. I mean, the poor girl just like really hit the wall. She shaved her head, she got into drugs and alcohol, she got institutionalized, she lost custody of her children. Point is that relationship, you know, damage is real. And no matter who you are and how much money you have, you cannot buffer it. And to just simply minimize it. And you look back at the beginning of her relationship with Federline, and you don't even need to know all of that stuff. When she met Federline, he was a backup dancer. This level went way up, and what other level went way up? This was their relationship in the beginning, you know, they got married within a year, and they, so there's just all kinds of things, and her parents wanted to get prenup, and she refused to get a prenup. So I just use her as an example, because you're kind of like, oh, that's Britney, you know, but listen, here's a person that has all of that going for her, and yet could probably have dated just about anybody she wanted to, got involved with a guy who's sharp, you know, if you know anything about Kevin Federline. When he got involved with Britney, his partner, Shar Jackson, was in her ninth month of pregnancy with their second child. So, you know, Britney made choices to get involved with a guy that obviously was cheating on a partner. And 5 years later, you know, after two kids with him, you know, what at least went through the rumor mill, who knows what really happened, but what went through the rumor mill was that he cheated on her. So, you know, all of a sudden, all that hits the fan, and, you know, history tends to what? Repeat itself. So I would just tell you, you know, they did not do a relationship in a way that built character and trustworthiness. They did a relationship in a very easy way with this exciting, energetic trust and sexual chemistry. But it didn't have the kind of foundation that relationships need to have to last a lifetime. Anything else? Yes, sir. Yeah, there's three areas of compatibility that we focus in on, and in research you'll notice there's a term that's called complementarity that has to do with ways that people blend their differences, which is very important. It's talked about in my book, but personality areas, which include from everything from appearance and chemistry, all the way down to sense of humor. You know, I always say my biological mother and my father had a great compatibility sense of humor. My dad was a real punster. You know, you get a new shirt. Like when I was growing up, I'd get a new shirt, and he'd be like, "Come here, let me see that, John." He grabbed my skin. He'd go, "What is that, felt?"
Oh.
So, gotta think about it. That's about as funny as we all thought he was. So. He had all these little puns. Like if you were eating a banana, he'd walk by and he'd be like, "Now that looks like one appealing banana." Peeling the banana. Well, I would avoid him when I ate bananas. I don't want to say I was traumatized, but it was getting there. And when I was 15 and he got remarried to my stepmom, you know, the joke was she didn't ever get his puns. And it all started with me sitting in the kitchen, and she was peeling a banana, and my father walked in, and I'm just kind of like watching them interact and analyzing them, of course. And he goes, "Now that looks like one peeling banana." And she goes, "Not really, it's got a bruise right here." Which, together, they were actually funnier for me. Their incompatibility was tough on them, but hey, it was a breath of fresh air for me. You are pretty funny together, you two. So, compatibility of personality, sense of humor. You'd be amazed at how many pretty large research studies were done about sense of humor. and the complementarity issues of humor and how they strengthen relationships. So personality is one major construct. Values is a second. We look in at different types of values. And then a third is just what I call lifestyle. And it talks about like hobbies and interests. What is interesting, when we teach this course, we used to like teach this stuff, you know? And it just became laundry lists. Now what we do is we break the class up into three groups, and we put one group in charge of personality, one group in charge of lifestyle, and one group in charge of values. And we ask them to list all the things they can think of that would be important to explore and to get to know about somebody, and what are the deal breakers, the non-negotiables, the things that you've, you know, got to have. And you'd be amazed at how well we already know things. We just haven't organized it in a user-friendly way. We just kind of lose it. And so a lot of the course, the way it's taught in different settings, is very interactional. And a lot of it, I'd say probably about 70%, comes out of, is generated by the class, and then the PowerPoint and the workbook kind of organizes what the class generated. But those are the three areas of compatibility. Yes, sir.
My dad would give me dating advice ever since I was little, and he'd always tell me to date a lot of girls. And I think that he told me that's the way it worked when he was dating. And I found out that that's not really the way it works anymore. People don't really date multiple people. And when I say that, I mean like, wouldn't get into exclusive relationships. You would just like go on dates with many different people. And so I was just wondering what you would say. I mean, I feel like now people expect that when you date someone, you just sort of exclude everyone else. And I just want to know what you think about that.
Oh, that's a good question. I think going into a more exclusive type of relationship real quickly sets
you up to maybe become overly reliant on that person. We've all known somebody that they get into a relationship and immediately they drop all their friends, you know, all their activities change, they kind of become hyper-focused on the individual. And if that's the kind of exclusivity we're talking about, I think that that's dangerous, because I think it looks like this in the beginning of a relationship, like you just become real dependent. And maybe, I mean, you're not married, but you know, your level of investment has just gone to the extreme. Now, on the flip side of things, probably the paradigm that tends to be just out there in the world right now is either you are going to be serious and exclusive, or you're hooking up. And so it's not just like dating around, but, and the hookup could mean anything, to be honest. You know, it all depends on who you're talking to, whether it's a, you know, just hooking up for, you know, it usually has some kind of sexual involvement, but it could be, you know, something as light as just kissing to oral, but it's very quick. It's like, it is, the concept of hookup is that these things have nothing to do with this, the whole concept. And that's something that I would say is, needs to be debunked, that we don't have any evidence anywhere in any of the sciences that you can engage in this and this has no involvement. You know, we know from biological studies, from brain scans about people that are just getting aroused, that their brain operates. You can't just get aroused, get involved, and have your brain not produce chemicals, have certain areas of the brain light up. And that's just biology, let alone investments. And we also know that pathways of the brain change as people have sexual partners. We know a lot about sexuality that needs to get translated to say, into just our culture, and say, listen, you're a whole human being. And when you go into a hookup, you take the all of you. You know, you don't just take a part of you. So from that standpoint, just kind of bouncing around in hookup relationships, I would say, can be just as detrimental as jumping into some exclusive relationship really fast. I think a better paradigm is to understand that if you like somebody, I mean, sometimes people are in a relationship for a while and they just can take it or leave it, and then their chemistry grows, you know. But most people, they start out with a lot of intensity. I mean, that's usually why they start going out. But I think if you can keep some boundaries in how much time you spend with them, and you keep your time kind of well distributed, and how far you go, and really depending on them or relying on them, or what you believe about them, know that it takes time to get to know those things. If you can keep some boundaries here, then I think a lot of times You can get to know a person, have a fairly decent relationship in the beginning. And well, you'll see romantic movies that do this sometimes. I mean, you have one romantic movie like, Sleepless in Seattle, where they have a relationship and then they meet and then they're married. I mean, it's like boom, 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 right? But then you have other ones where they build a relationship over a period of time. And at first, kind of like when Harry met Sally, where they have this chemistry and it's like differences and they see each other's personalities and they don't hide anything, but they really build things. Oh, that really dated me, didn't it, when Harry met Sally? You're like, I remember seeing that movie in the archives. Yeah, sorry about that. But you know what I'm saying. Is that you see, I think if you set some boundaries and you know what you're doing, then in the beginning of a relationship, even if you have a tremendous like interest, you get to know a person. One of the strangest cases I had was a married woman that before she was married, she had a sexual experience. It was a one-night stand with a guy, and it had literally traumatized her. Not the experience itself, but later when she realized who the guy was. And she'd met him in a bar, and they drank together, and she said he was really nice, and they were funny, and they were laughing, and they went out together. Next thing you know, they're out having sex together, and it wasn't real long after that he got arrested, and it hit national news, and she realized that she had had intimate relations. I mean, it wasn't just like kissing or anything. She had gone all the way with Jeffrey Dahmer, and she just said, you know, if he had been killing women, I would have been dead. And it really traumatized her from the standpoint that she realized that she had, you know, just the images, had gotten involved with somebody that she didn't know. And that is a real extreme example of what happens over and over. You'll hear many people that somewhere around the third month, they'll be like, well, I thought I really knew him, but, or I thought I really knew her, but. And you'll hear that over and over. And when you look at their relationship development, they develop these things in areas that were way beyond what they knew. And they felt safe, and they engaged in different activities, but they backfired, and as a result, they really got hurt. And I think a lot of that is what you need to reduce in your relationships.
Unfortunately, that has to be the last question.
Thank you so much. Okay, thank you all.
Thank you.